It's kind of a miracle to meet someone like that in this life.
I'm so lucky to have seen it.
There was no rhyme or reason to it.
Mia was doing something that was unique in 1993, and it's unique today.
Before there was a band, or before there was a show, or before there was a rehearsal, there was our friendship and our loyalty to one another.
And when you see the footage and you see how close they were, and you see Andy and Mia joking on stage, and you see this rapport.
A microphone in her hand, march her up on a stage, and she was just magnetic.
It somehow came up in the studio with Joan, and she's just like, we gotta do something.
This was the beginning, you know, of so much great stuff to come.
27-year-old Mia Zapata was a singer on the brink of making it big, but it's all over now.
I'll go to my grave saying that they never met till that night.
It's just my daughter, you know, my daughter Mia Zapata. She was on loan to me. She now belongs to all of you.
Everybody was just blown away and just stunned and just grasping at anything and trying to figure it out. And it was a mystery. It was a grand mystery.
It really had to be devastating, you know? So I really think it's admirable what they did. And I think Mia would be proud of them, what they did.
The amount of bands that got involved, which was the Posies, Presidents of the United States, Nirvana, when Kurt was alive, Eddie Vedder, Soundgarden, and they all brought things. I remember, I think Soundgarden lent us the some of the equipment, like the drums and whatnot.
I wanted to do the music proud. I wanted to do a good job. I wanted to raise a lot of money, you know, to make sure, you know, we were able to give the private eye something good and helpful. I'll still never forget the day I got a phone call from Steve Moriarty. No hello, no nothing. We got him.
Ladies and gentlemen, I am the American Spy Fox. Welcome to the channel. As Jones said, they did get Mia Zapata's murder, but it took a very long time. Personally, I am a firm believer that there is no perfect crime. There is no perfect murder, and the truth will come out eventually, no matter how long it takes. Today, or rather tonight as I work on this video, I want to recount for you Mia Zapata's story, not just her death, but also her life. As I put in the community post, I did not know when Mia was kidnapped, when she was assaulted, anything. I thought I knew the story. You always think you know the story until you start researching it, and then you realize there's all these details that you would have had no way of knowing. I didn't even know what month Mia was kidnapped and murdered, and it was just a huge coincidence that I finally decided to get off my ass and tell Mia's story. I start researching her, and I'm like looking at the paragraph, you know, Mia was kidnapped July 6th, her body was found July 7th, and I look down at the date and it's July 6th, and I'm researching what happened to her on the same night it happened to her 28 years ago. And I really started to take it personally. I almost had this eerie feeling that the terror she must have went through. If anybody, male or female, if you can read Mia's story and learn what happened to her at what point in her life when she was on the brink of success and a tear not come to your eye, then you're a cold-hearted son of a bitch. I'm not saying there was any divine intervention. It was just a huge coincidence that I chose the same night she died to start researching her, and quite frankly it freaked me out a little bit. But now I'm taking it personally, and I understand the fear and the terror she went through, and I'm working through the night until this video's done. I'm not stopping until it's done. If anything positive could come out of someone's death, something positive did come out of Mia's death. It fueled the feminist movement. Mia's death is really what kickstarted everything. It's what got Nirvana and Soundgarden and all those other bands involved in the Get Home Alive project, the benefit shows. The girls in the band 7 Year Bitch were friends of Mia's as well, and they took a lot of that money and put it into a studio that would teach women self-defense classes. If you're a female in Seattle and you want to carry a gun, they'll teach you how to handle a gun. If you want to just learn how to knock somebody's head off their fucking shoulders, they'll teach you that too. Because of the bands playing the benefit shows, these classes were free to whatever female wanted them. It woke people up to the dangers in their small city. There was this false sense of security. It's dim and drizzly, and everybody knows each other, and everybody plays in bands, and there are coffee shops everywhere where people hang out. When you get into that mentality that I know everybody and everybody's my friend, you get a false sense of security, which is exactly why Mia felt comfortable walking around by herself at 2 in the morning. Remember, she's a rising star and she has fans who follow her, and she was said to have friends all over Seattle, so to Mia, she was safe wherever she went. And unfortunately, she crossed the path of a psycho killer. Mia's murder really lit a fire under people's asses in Seattle and let the public know, let everyone know how dangerous it was just for a woman to walk home at night. People started to be safer, stay in groups, and they started to fight back against that behavior. And I mean literally fight back. There were tons of women taking martial arts classes, boxing classes, self-defense classes, purchasing pistols. You know, they're like, you want it, come and get it kind of shit, because no one should have to deal with that kind of behavior to begin with. Lest we forget, this is also the period of time that Green River killer Gary Ridgway is operating Seattle's Aurora Strip. Some people thought maybe he had something to do with Mia's murder. The police, not so much. He had a certain MO. He would take prostitutes off the strip, dump them in the river. But there was some mystery surrounding Mia's death. We're going to get to her story right now. First, I want to talk about her life. Let's talk about a little bit about her life, then we'll talk about her death. Mia was born in Chicago, August 25th, 1965, putting her death at, yes, age 27. She is one of the 27 Club. I hate to put it that way, but how strange it is, right? She was born to Richard and Donna Zapata. Both of her parents were TV executives. These were very wealthy people. And Mia could have taken the easy route. She had a very easy life. Even though her parents divorced in 81, her father soon remarried. They relocated to Louisville, Kentucky. Mia had the ideal childhood. No real complaint about her parents being divorced. She still had a great childhood, was given anything she wanted. But here's the thing that I really respect about Mia Zapata. She could have just allowed her mother or father to hand her some high-paying TV salary job, and she could have worked behind the scenes. Her parents were very high-up TV executives, but she didn't. She wanted to forge her own path. She wanted to express herself creatively. She took off on her own. She could have allowed daddy to give her that high-paying salary, but instead she ends up becoming a dishwasher. We'll get to that. Mia was bit by the rock and roll bug, and all she cared about from there on out was expressing herself through her music. And it's no shock that when she decided to go to college, she went to Yellow Springs, Ohio's Antioch College. What's so special about Antioch College? This is a university. It's been around since 1850, and it prides itself on the student forging their own path, creating their own curriculum. You can even make your own major there. To this day, Antioch College is all about innovation through the liberal arts, theater, painting, music, dance, even comedy. However you can express yourself creatively, that's what they're about. It may come as no surprise to you that comedian Dave Chappelle's father, William Chappelle, was the Antioch College Dean of Students for a period of time, and he was a vocal instructor at the college. Mia Zapata would have known Dave Chappelle's father. She may have taken a class with him as her instructor, and definitely at such a small college, she would have crossed his path. I wonder if she ever crossed a young Dave Chappelle's path while staying with his father, skateboarding around the college. Contrary to popular belief, the Getz did not form in Seattle. show. The Getz formed at Antioch College in Yellow Springs, Ohio. The Getz gigged around the Ohio college scene for 3 years before relocating to Seattle together. Andy, Matt, and Steve were fellow classmates of Mia. 3 years after they started the band, they decided to relocate to Seattle. Now, why would they do this? Well, because everybody was going to Seattle at this time. After all, if you want to be famous in Hollywood, better get your ass to Hollywood, right? It's the same concept. Everybody was going to Seattle at this time. They went to Seattle in 1989. Nirvana just released Bleach. It was on the cusp of the grunge movement. Things were happening. It was exciting in the Pacific Northwest, and people were moving there from all over the world. Not only were bands moving there, fans of the music genre were moving there just so they could watch the bands they loved. There was this general excitement that you could go out to a club any night of the week and the band that you are watching might be the next big thing, might be the next Jane's Addiction, might be the next Screaming Trees, might be the next Soundgarden, might be the next Nirvana. Well, for the Getz, they really were the next Nirvana. That was taken from them. So you have to understand that this isn't just a band, this was a family. They lived together, loved together, laughed together, cried together for 3 years in college, formed this tight, cohesive band of friends, also talented musicians, and then relocated together clear across the country. They went on this grand adventure, this endeavor together. And when Mia was taken from them, they were not going to stop until they found her killer. And they did not stop for 10 plus years. It was more than just their lead singer, it was their sister. So personally, I'm proud to say that the Getz is an Ohio band relocated to Seattle. The band didn't have much money. They weren't exactly doing what their parents wanted them to do, but they knew that they were chasing a dream and they were going to give it everything they had. They ended up finding an abandoned house on Capitol Hill in Capitol Hill District and living there and rehearsing there. They dubbed the house the Rat House, which I'm sure it probably had lots of mice and rats in it. Very quickly, there was a buzz around the Getz. They made friends with the girls from 7 Year Bitch and other female musicians around the city. To at least feed herself and help feed her brothers in arms, her band, Mia got a job at the Deluxe Bar and Grill as a dishwasher. Now, she was quite capable and intelligent enough to take on a real job, but she didn't want a straight job. She wanted a job with leniency, one where she could just go to her boss and say, hey, I'm going on tour for a couple weeks down the West Coast with my band. I need time off. This is why she got the dishwashing job. Later, a hostess at the Deluxe Bar and Grill would write about Mia and say that she would often hear Babes in Toyland blaring from the kitchen. Whenever Mia was working, she loved the band Babes in Toyland. She loved 7 Year Bitch. And her favorite song was Bruise Violet, a song that Courtney Love and Capjellan would argue over and say they stole from each other. That's a whole other story. By 1993, Mia is still working as a dishwasher. They've put out one early compilation of early songs. They just finished their second studio album, Enter the Conquering Chicken. The title of this album really resonates with me because it's someone using an old weakness to be their strength. Let me explain. When Mia was young, she had a very wide, lanky sort of gait, and her schoolmates would pick on her and call her a chicken. She walked like a chicken. And obviously, that would be traumatizing for any kid when you get picked on as a young kid. It's not a good feeling, but as an adult, she embraced it, and she even tattooed a chicken on her leg, took the nickname Chicken, and decided, well, if that's what I am, then I'm a conquering chicken. By embracing this childhood nickname that was meant to taunt her and make fun of her, she takes the power away from the name and makes it her own. That's how much confidence Mia had at this time. She knew her band was going places. In fact, that's what makes her tragedy all the more unbearable. The Getz were just about to go on an American tour, followed by a European tour, followed by another American tour. They were going to be touring that newly finished album, Enter the Conquering Chicken. They were going to take over the world with their music. 3 days before they were getting ready to leave is when this tragedy struck, And oddly, Steve Moriarty, the Gits drummer, tells us later that only 2 weeks beforehand, Mia was in the rehearsal studio and wrote a song about her own death at the hands of a serial killer, what became a self-fulfilling prophecy. And on July 6, 1993, she went to the Comet Tavern with her band, with her friends, with fans, to celebrate the finish of their second studio album and their first real managed, financed tour. It was around midnight, so we're going into July 7th. Her friends say that she left to go to a nearby apartment and studio. There was a rehearsal studio within the apartment building. Her friend also lived there. She was going to visit a friend. She left on foot. She made it to her friend's apartment. Her friend later would say that she tried to get Mia to spend the night. Don't worry about getting home. You're drunk. You don't need to be walking anywhere or hailing a cab. Just stay here. But Mia said, no, I have things to do in the morning. I've got to go. I'm going to go hail a cab. I'll be fine. Around 2 a.m. in the morning, July 7th, 1993, she left with her Gits hoodie up and her headphones on, listening to her newly finished album that she was about to go out on the road and perform for the world. She would not have heard the car pull up on her. She would not have heard her killer approach her for the hoodie and the Walkman she was listening to. Less than an hour and a half later, at 3:20 a.m., Mia's body was discovered lying on a dead-end street by a walking pedestrian. Her right leg lay over her left leg, her arms stretched out into a cross. On one side of the street was a Catholic church. On the other side of the street was a Catholic Community Services Center. Because of the way in which Mia's body was displayed and the location in between the two religious centers, it led some people to believe that it may have been a fanatical religious zealot who felt as though Mia was immoral and deserved to be punished. Others believed it was the work of the Green River Killer, Gary Ridgway, who had yet to be caught. The pedestrian who found Mia was only one block away from a firehouse, and she ran over to get some firemen. They did tried to resuscitate Mia as her body was still warm. She had expired just moments before she was found. Later, the deputy medical examiner, who was actually the first person to identify Mia, he was able to identify her because he himself was a fan of the blossoming grunge movement. Yes, I'm talking about Dr. Nicholas Hartshorne, the same deputy medical examiner who did Kurt Cobain's autopsy, the same deputy medical examiner who did Kristen Fast autopsy, is the person who identified Mia. He had been to see her band several times. If you recall from my other videos, Nicholas Hartshorne used some of his trust fund to promote bands. He even promoted Courtney Love's first husband's band, The Leaving Train's James Morland. That obviously didn't work out for him. He knew Mia, and there's one really great thing that I can say about Nicholas Hartshorne, even if I don't agree with the way that he handled Kurt Cobain's autopsy or Kristen Fast autopsy. He did something that took a lot of forward thinking. At this point in time, DNA evidence is very new, and only the largest samples of DNA can be tested. There was a bite mark on Mia's breast left by her killer, and Nicholas Hartshorne had the forethought to swab that bite mark and keep it in a freezer for future test. He knew that DNA testing technology would enhance, and over time, he knew that it would reveal her killer. However, in the meantime, that did nothing to help those that were left behind. Her friends, her fans, her family, they all wanted answers. And it came to this point where a lot of people who knew Mia felt like the police weren't really doing anything. Now, the problem was there was no evidence left behind that would lead them anywhere. It was Kathleen Hanna, Joan Jett, Kurt Cobain, and surprisingly, Courtney Love, who came up with this idea, why don't we just hire our own private investigator? Joan gets together with the remaining members of the Gits, and they play benefit shows, and they put all the money into private investigator Leigh Heron. She goes out, she talks to everybody. She walks the streets, she talks to prostitutes, drug dealers, she goes in clubs. No one can find a lead. Nothing. A lot of the benefit money goes towards women's self-defense classes, gun weapons training, things that I'm sure came in useful to a lot of women in Seattle. But in the end, It would be a Nobel Peace Prize winner who finally cracked the case wide open. A chemist by the name of Terry Mullis wins the Nobel Prize for inventing a technique called polymerase chain reaction. Now, obviously, I'm not a chemist and I can't tell you the deep down science of it, but what I can tell you is basically it amplifies a sample. If you have a very tiny sample, it duplicates it and amplifies it so it can be tested. Remember, at this time, only very large amounts of DNA can be tested. The sample that Nicholas Hartshorne had got from the swab off the bite mark on Mia's breast was so small that they waited several years until the PCR technique was so refined that they felt confident it would not be damaged in the process. 8 years after Mia Zapata was brutally sexually assaulted, beaten, and strangled, they were finally able to come up with a sample large enough to test, and it yielded results. They came up with an unknown man's DNA. So from there, it was just put this DNA into the CODIS system, which is something that links all law enforcement agencies throughout the United States. If you've ever been convicted of a felony, you are forced to turn over a DNA sample. So they're thinking, a guy who could commit such a heinous act, he's probably done other crimes. He's probably in our system. They run it through the CODIS system, no match. But here's the great thing about computers. They don't need sleep. They don't need rest. They don't need to eat. All they need is electricity, and they keep running. So for 12 months, the CODIS system is running this DNA over and over and over again. 12 months later, it comes up on a match. The guy had been arrested in Florida, 3,000 miles away, forced to turn over his DNA, and they got him. The DNA matched a man named Jesus Mesquia. He would have been around 39 years old when he brutally assaulted and strangled and beat Mia Zapata. He is a worthless individual. He's not even worth your time looking at, or he doesn't even deserve a slot in your memory bank. He brought nothing to the world. The only thing he ever did was took away someone who could have brought good to the world. Furthermore, he didn't even belong in America. He was a Cuban refugee. Now, what does this mean? For those of you who don't know the story, Fidel Castro just decided one day that he was sick and tired of using his country's taxes to pay for the criminals in his jails and prisons. So he gathered them all up, put them on boats, and sent them to Florida, and they became refugees. He literally let out the worst of the worst, the rapists, the murderers, the child molesters. He just sent them on boats to America for us to deal with. Jesus Mesquia should have never even fucking been in America. To begin with, he should have never met Mia Zapata. He should have never walked the same ground she walked on. If you still don't know what I'm referring to, for further reference, watch the movie Scarface. This man wanted nothing more than just to inflict pain on someone. The medical examiner's office said that had she not died of asphyxiation, strangled with the cord of her own band's hoodie, that she would have died of internal bleeding. This is how badly he beat, bit, and strangled her. A woman he'd never met, a woman who did him no wrong, a woman he should have never even had the chance to reach out and touch. God only knows what he did in Cuba to be put in prison in Cuba and then exiled by Fidel Castro. He probably killed and raped women in Cuba. That's probably why they got rid of him. You know, I watched an interview with a couple of the girls from the band 7 Year Bitch, and they said, during the years that we didn't know who Mia's killer was, we always wondered, had she had self-defense classes, had she knew how to defend herself, could she have fought off this killer? And once they finally saw him in court and how big this man was, the homicide detective said that his hands were as big as baseball mitts. He was this giant, gargantuan monster. They said to themselves when they saw him in court, Mia could have done nothing. But here is one thing that could have helped her, a gun. And I'll just leave it at that. Jesus Mesquia died just this year in a prison cell, January 21st, 2021. The world will not remember him, but the world will remember Mia Zapata and all the joy she brought with her music and her creativity and her bluesy Janis Joplin-like vocals. That's who I would liken Mia Zapata to. She was a blues singer in a punk rock band. The one thing Jesus Mesquia did not count on was who he was fucking with. I'd bet you anything he had no clue who she was. He had no clue how loved she was. And he had no clue how persistent her brothers, because her bandmates were more than just bandmates. They were like brother and sisters. He had no clue how persistent they would be in catching him. They weren't going to give up until her killer was caught. And I'm happy to say that he was caught, and he's gone. He won't be remembered, but Mia will.